students, you must be surprised to know that why such a slogan in the beginning of the video, isn't it? Hum do, hamare do. Well, that has something to do with today's chapter, that is reproductive health. Today we are going to read about the reproductive health, which is our final chapter in the unit of reproduction. After knowing about the human reproduction, let us see this topic of reproductive health in a more broader aspect. Now, the first thing which you should be knowing about this is that why this chapter has been introduced in your curriculum. The reason is very clear to know. The reason is because you are now in your adolescent stage, which you are now going to cross very soon after 1 or 2 years, and you will be entering into your adulthood. Now, adulthood is something which is independent. People think themselves to be independent. I don't know how far we become independent of our parents, but of course many decisions related to our life we have to take up, and if we are not clear about the things which is going to happen in our future, we cannot take a right decision, isn't it? So reproductive health is somewhat like that. This topic is something which we are not interested to talk with everyone. We feel sometimes shy to talk about. We don't want to face it, rather. We sometimes go for some easy materials available to us, sometimes some books, sometimes, you know, some journals, sometimes some, you know, TV things and all those, internet and all. And then we are misguided. So that you are not misguided, and you know perfectly what this reproductive health is and why it is there in your syllabus, or what is the importance of knowing this reproductive health. This chapter has been introduced in your syllabus. Now, WHO, you know, has been talking about health and disease too much. Now, health, according to WHO, is the total well-being of a person in terms of the physical, mental, social well-being of a person, and not mere the absence of disease, isn't it? But reproductive health, WHO has introduced one new term along with it. You can see the definition of the reproductive health, which states that it's a total well-being in all aspects of reproduction: physical, emotional, behavioral and social. You see, this word behavioral has been introduced. Now, this behavioral word was not present in case of the normal definition of the health. Now, why this has been introduced? Reproductive health does not mean a person with normal reproductive organs and their normal functioning. It means achieving all these things, normal achieving of physical, emotional, behavioral and social aspect of reproductive health. If your behavior towards the society is not normal related to reproductive health, that may lead to an unhealthy society having full of sex crimes, abuses, which presently is the scenario. And there are many issues related to reproductive health like this. If you're not aware, you may not even know various kinds of diseases you will be acquiring unknowingly if your behavior is not proper, if you are not behaviorally normal in terms of your reproductive health. So knowing something is good, but applying it in the society, until and unless you have a full knowledge about the subject, you cannot do so. So reproductive health really helps us to behave normally and properly in the society, so that our society is normal, we live a normal life, our children live a normal life, and we have a safe and sound society in our country. Not in our country, but also in the world. That is the purpose behind knowing this reproductive health in this class. Next, now to achieve this total, you know, motto of physical, emotional, behavioral and social aspect of the reproductive health, we are facing a lot of problems. Not only we, the government of India and the people all across the world, I think many governments in many countries have faced this problem, but we will be talking about the Indian government or the general problem faced to achieve this aspect. Now let us see these problems. Lack of awareness in the people. Now, India is a highly populous country. It is second in terms of population. Now, since it is second in terms of population, the basic amenities like the education, food, shelter, this should be, you know, provided to everyone. But fortunately or unfortunately, government is trying so hard to impart free education to the children even up to, you know, 10th standard. But still people, due to some reason or the other, are not totally literate in India. So literacy problem really makes people unaware of the facts related to that of the reproductive health. So if a person is not literate, you cannot make that person understand what is reproductive health, what are the problems related to reproductive health, how can the reproductive health be achieved, what are the problems faced by the adolescent during the time of, you know, their puberty periods, how can they tackle or how will they be, you know, counseled properly. So this all things cannot be done until and unless the people are literate, the people are educated. So lack of awareness in the people in India, one of the prime reason is because of proper lack of education or illiteracy among them. Next is a number of myths and misconceptions about sex related aspects. Now this myths and misconception, of course, again comes because of lack of awareness, that is because of, you know, illiteracy. Now myths and misconceptions, what are they? Like during the time of our menstrual cycle, the female should not go to the kitchen for work, female should not go to the holy places for work. Now all these are the myths and the taboos associated with that of the menstrual cycle, but people should understand that it is a normal physiological changes which happen in a female just for 5 to 7 days, okay, and after that she's also having her normal life. So we have to support her during that time. We have to make her understand when she first faces this problem and menarche happens in her, that this is a normal thing which happens with every female. So you don't have to get, you know, afraid of, you don't have to fear of, and we have to clear all the doubts what how they should maintain the hygiene, especially because if they are not maintaining the hygiene during the time of the menstrual cycle, they can face various kinds of diseases later on, which could be very unhealthy for her life. There can be some, you know, because of stress, because of too much of emotional disturbance, she can even have irregular periods. So all these misconceptions and myths should be tackled with, you know, calm and coolness by the adults in the home, by the family members, by the friends, by the teachers, or anybody who is close to that person. Now in case of some, this can be a problem with the boy also who comes in the puberty age, that is what kind of physiological changes happen in the boy. So they also have to be taught that this is a normal part of their life and they have to take it normally as it comes. It is nothing unnatural which is happening in their life, okay. And then male have the problem, that is their foreskin is attached with that of the external genitalia. So if a parent, being a parent, if you come to know that this is the problem with my child, then circumcision can be done. At an early age, if the circumcision is done, it will hardly take, you know, half an hour or a few minutes to do this thing, and later on the boy, when he will be growing up, he will not face any kinds of problems. And circumcision is a good practice which is done in various religious communities also, which can even prevent penile cancer. It can prevent various kinds of STDs, that is sexually transmitted diseases. So myths and taboos should be tackled by the proper knowledge of reproductive health to both the adolescents, that is growing girl and a growing boy. Okay, next is a rapid increase in human population. Now India is, as I told you, second in terms of population, and the World Population Day, I have marked it, July 11th is the World Population Day. Now this population keeps on growing because of the proper availability of food, space and all, but a time comes when the growth rate increases so much that the resources becomes, you know, insufficient to meet the requirements of the growing population, and that is what is called as your population explosion. And if it happens, then the motto of the reproductive health cannot be achieved, even if you have a lots and lots of, you know, family planning programs and various strategies to tackle the problems. So it cannot be, because resources are limited, isn't it? So during that time, the nature takes its role, the nature, you know, to minimize this pressure of the population and on the resources, the pressure sets up a kind of, you know, kind of natural disasters or some kinds of pandemics or epidemics, and then control the population, and again it starts. So this is how the rapid increase in the human population is one of the hindrance towards achieving a proper reproductive health. Next is female foeticides. Now this female foeticides is done on the basis of knowing the that is the sex of the individual before the birth. Now before the birth, what happens is that perhaps you remember there is an amniotic sac around the embryo in which the developing embryo sheds some of the body cells. Now if those cells are tested, the chromosomal study is made, we can determine various kinds of chromosomal disorders, like for example your Down syndrome, color blindness, hemophilia, thalassemia, Klinefelter syndrome. Many things can be known beforehand. That is a good thing, that is a good point of your amniocentesis. But when it is done to detect the sex of an individual, whether the sex of the individual is, you know, it's a female or it's a male, and once you come to know that it's a female, then the female is aborted prior to its birth, and that is called as your female foeticides. Now if female foeticide is done, think about what will happen. The sex ratio will be disbalanced, isn't it? Now if the sex ratio is disbalanced, that will of course again lead to sexual crimes in the society, because sexual desire is a natural desire or a natural drive of any kind of organism. So if that drive is not satisfied, if they do not have a healthy or marriage life, if they don't have a partner to live a healthy life, then definitely they will be, you know, urging towards other female in the society, and that will relate to, you know, mentally disturbed people in our society. That will increase the rate of crime in our society. So that is to be tackled very seriously. People have to be educated right from the beginning how to control their behavior, how to have a proper emotion towards the other opposite sex, how to respect the female. All these things should be kept into account, and female foeticide is banned, and it should not be practiced under any circumstances illegally also by any couple in any circumstances in this present 21st century at least. Next is congenital or acquired infertility. Now we are thinking about limiting our population. Simultaneously, we have to also think about those couples who are infertile. Now this infertility can be also in terms of a male, or it can be in terms of a female, that if the female is not ovulating properly, this is a problem with the female. But every time female is not responsible for not delivering a child, even a male is also sometimes responsible. The sperm count is poor. Even the sperm count is good, then the sperm is not healthy, sperm is not motile. So all this can be a reason for not having a baby for that couple. So all these things are studied under the topic which is called as your art. Okay, now this art is what? Now this art is assisted reproductive technology. Under this you will be reading about gift and so many other things, that is your even test tube babies and all those things. So that is actually helping the couple who are not able to have their normal child, and they can have the child by means of this assisted reproductive technology, and they can also become parents. Now the next thing which is discussed here is India has 17.2% of the total world population, but it has only 2.42% of the total land of the world. Now, this is a serious issue, don't you think so? This is a serious issue. That means what? If you count the number of people, no, six people standing in front of you, out of the six people, the sixth one, every sixth one is an Indian. India every year is adding a population of 16 million population, which is slightly less than the population of Australia. Australia is such a big country land wise if you talk about, but population of Australia is very less, maybe because of the topography or the geographical conditions residing over there. We are not going for that, but India is every year adding a population of Australia. So that is a serious issue. Now, how this can be tackled? These problems we have now discussed. Now, next we are going to discuss about the strategies implemented by the government to tackle these problems. So let us see the strategies what Indian government is taking or is considering or even, you know, regularly seeing it, going through it or trying to improve it so as to achieve total reproductive health for our society and to have a limited population which will lead India to a developed country after so many years of independence. Now, after the problems, let us see what are the strategies given by the government to tackle these problems. Now, strategies regarding the health, reproductive health is improve programs in reproductive related areas. Now, improvement in programs, what are these programs? The family planning programs, which in the initial stage of the video I told you that India soon after the independence in 1951 was the first country to introduce this family planning program as a, you know, social agenda for achieving a total reproductive health. And this was perhaps, you know, regularly it is being assessed by the government as well as the officials to know what is the progress made in this regard. Now, under this improved programs in reproductive related areas is RCH, reproductive child health programs, reproductive child health care programs. What are these programs? These programs include the total reproductive health of the mother during the time of the pregnancy, that is the prenatal stage, during the pregnancy period, the postnatal stage, after the delivery period, regular inspection, introspection of the child, regular USGs, regular consultation with the doctor, when to go to a doctor, what for, what are the problems, what precautions. Even the mother also should have a proper time vaccination so that the child, when it is born, it's free from the various kinds of diseases. She should have a perfect balanced diet during her pregnancy period so that the child, when it is born, it is not suffering from any kind of, you know, vitamin deficiency related diseases or any kind of, you know, other abnormalities. Family planning programs, as I told you, it is hum do hamare do, as the slogan goes in the beginning of the video, that how we can achieve a society or a healthy reproductively healthy society of India, so where we can have a limited family members and where we can give the proper amenities, the basic amenities to our children so that India can progress in every field. So if a family is in limit size, we can effort to provide them all the necessary amenities of the life, including the education, including the job, including a security. So everything lies in a small family or a happy family. The next is creating awareness among the people by TV advertisements, handbills, counseling young couples. Now, TV plays a major role. TV is a media which everybody is, you know, interested to. So if the government and the non-government agencies say about the various kinds of health issues or reproductive related issues in the media, then people catch it more better. We have TV personalities, film personalities who are always, you know, encouraging people to achieve a small family, to have a better life, to have a proper reproductive healthy society. So all these can be achieved by means of the media. Now, counseling the young couples, the people who are have just got married, if they are regularly counseled by the medical practitioner or by the health officials to how to limit their family size, how to have spacing between the two children so that both of them can be brought up, you know, in a good atmosphere, in a congenial atmosphere, what should they do, how the birth control practices can be implemented in the family, how after achieving the total family, that is hum do hamare do, whether we can go for some permanent method of birth control or not, so that we can have a healthy reproductive society, we can have the reproductive health achieved, as well as the sexual desire of the person is also not at stake, so a person can lead a normal life, normal reproductively healthy life, if they have a regular counseling with that of the people who are associated with all these programs. Next is that is sex education in schools. Now this is of course a part of our curriculum in which the sex education is introduced in our curriculum so as to make the children, I will not say children now because now you are in the stage of adolescence, you will be going next to your adulthood life when you go to your colleges, so that you have a proper knowledge about the reproductive health or whatever changes are happening in your body during the time of adolescence, so that you don't have, you know, any kind of fear or any kind of misconceptions about them, and you can also take a wise decision. So the decision making in your life also depends upon knowing the reproductive aspect of the health properly, which should be done at the school level. If we are curious, because you know the human nature is curious, so if we can satisfy our that is your questions at this level, and we make it crystal clear at this age itself, then we will be not taking any kind of wrong decision in the future which can affect our family, which can affect us, which can affect our career, which can affect our future. So it's very much essential that the reproductive education, reproductive health related education must be introduced, which CBSE has introduced in the school level or in the school curriculum. Next is your information. Information related to STDs. Now this is very much important. You know, STDs means sexually transmitted diseases, and AIDS is one of them. Now sexually transmitted diseases are so harmful and so contagious, you can't even imagine. And if we are totally aware of how do they spread and how can we prevent it, then possibly we can control this problem of STDs, because there is no solution to the problems of AIDS. Once a person becomes HIV positive, it is very difficult for the person to, you know, mentally become stable, because a person is in our society still boycotted. If a person is HIV positive, people don't accept that person, whether it is colleagues in the office, whether it is family members in the home, so the person is totally depressed. So it's not only about a disease a person is suffering with, the person is also mentally suffering. So all this can be avoided if we have a proper knowledge about this STDs, how do they get transmitted and what can we do, how can we maintain our that is your hygiene, sexual hygiene, especially during the time of periods, or you know, some male have the problem of the foreskin, which is, you know, attached to that of their male external genitalia. So if it is circumcision is done, so circumcision of that will prevent any kind of sexually transmitted diseases in them. Also sometimes serious issues like, you know, penile cancer also can be prevented if circumcision is done, which is of course a custom in case of some religions and all, but I'm not going for that. But it is a good practice of circumcision. If it is done, then we can avoid many kinds of problems. In case of female, if they are hygienically, you know, maintaining themselves during the time of sexual menstrual cycle, so if they are maintaining that thing, they are using the sanitary napkins properly, which are disposable sanitary napkins, in that case there is less chances, you won't believe, 50% less chances of cervical cancers, which the mostly the Indian ladies are suffering from. So all these can be prevented if we have a proper knowledge during our adolescent period in the school level itself about the reproductive health in a proper manner under the guidance of somebody. Next is statutory ban on amniocentesis. Now statutory ban on amniocentesis, I have told in the beginning that amniocentesis means testing the amniotic fluid for knowing the chromosomal pattern of the individual. But this practice is not done only to know the chromosomal disorders the individual is suffering from, but it is also sometimes done to know the sex of the individual. And unfortunately, if the sex of the individual is detected to be the female, in that case female 40 site is undergoing, and various illegal, you know, nursing homes are there in our countries where this kind of practice is still going on illegally, of course. But it Supreme Court has, you know, made a ban on this amniocentesis for for this female 40 site. But again, that is MTP, that is you will be reading it in the further part of this class. That is medical termination of pregnancy. It is legalized now. In 1971, it has been legalized. Now, why it has been legalized? If a person is having so severe birth defects or disorders, which the person after birth is going to suffer from, and the family members also will be suffering, isn't it? So in that case, it is better to abort the child before the birth. So that is called as your medical termination of pregnancy. Mind it. Medical termination of pregnancy is not a permanent method of contraception. It is just one pregnancy which is aborted. It does not mean that the female cannot have the next pregnancy. So sometimes students make a mistake that it is a permanent method of getting rid of pregnancy. No, it is not. Vasectomy and tubectomy is there. We will be reading about it in details in our next classes, but just to make you understand what is MTP and why it is done, that is why I have told you all these things. The next is birth control. Of course, now birth control practices are done in India. Saheli, the contraceptive pills, which is totally, you can say, indigenous to India. The Indian scientist in Lucknow, that is your CDRI, that is Central Drugs and Research Institute of Lucknow, they have made this by themselves, and it is a non-steroidal contraceptive pill. Now, non-steroidal contraceptive pills have very less side effect on the health of the person who is taking it, and as a result there could be a proper spacing between the children. So if a couple is using this kind of contraceptive pills, and it's a weekly contraceptive pill, you don't have to take it regularly also. So weekly, once if you take it, the effect is so long lasting and so positive and so sure, and it has very less other side effects on the health of the female, that it is very popular in India. So these are the various kinds of initiatives taken by the government, and still research is, research is something which keeps on going, and government is encouraging the scientists or the researchers to find more and more advanced technologies so that we can minimize the population in our country, we can control the population in our country, and we can be a better country in future. So this is all about the introductory part of the reproductive health. We will be reading further about the birth control methods and various, infertility techniques, how they can be overcome by means of art, that we will be reading in the next class.